open source might not have, you know, Google Summer of Code or Outreach in their mind. Okay, so I volunteer as an org admin of GSOC, so I'm supposed to talk about GSOC and things, and maybe that's why I'm also here. So please keep this in mind, and this is not the only, you know, reason why people should contribute to open source. It's more or less fun. Okay, so just keep this in mind, and I hope you guys are also interested in this, right? Yes. So before I start, like, how many of you guys over here have already done GSOC or Outreach? Okay, good. This is like a pretty nice number. Yes. All right. So today, I got 30 minutes. So yeah, the boring short stuff. You know, I need to keep it there somewhere. So my quick open source story. Like everyone, all their story. So I thought, okay, I thought maybe I can show. Mind you, then how to start with any organization. This might be a bit more interesting thing because I heard a couple of, you know, participants over there talking like how to really start with something. You just have this feeling, okay, I'm gonna try and get in Google Summer Code and how do I start with it? Yeah, that's gonna be a bit interesting, okay, less boring. Then basic requirements, there are some few basic requirements. Then GSOC and Outreach, yeah, the usual thingy. Then preparing a proposal, what exactly is this thing? This also might be a bit interesting, okay? So if you're planning to sleep off, maybe you can skip the first part, you know, do your stuff. But maybe the last few sections might be a bit interesting to you, okay? So, oh yeah, then my new idea. So the whole point of my initial presentation topic was just the last part, okay? So it's kind of like superficial, lot of drama involved and lot of optimism, but you might like it. Okay, so just it's interesting. So yes, by the end, yes, I can assure you that. Yeah, I'm waiting to see this. Okay, so this is the usual short slide I usually all of my presentation, but trust me, like, you know, I remote a lot of contents from it. So 2014, I was a GSOC student with Wikimedia Foundation, and my first patch to MediaWiki was in 2013 September. So I'll be using these terms, MediaWiki, Wikimedia, then Wikipedia, etc. So you need to get some basic understanding. Wikimedia Foundation is the organization, okay? The organization. MediaWiki is the software, okay? So Wikimedia Foundation maintains, along with volunteers, this media software. So 2014, I was a GSOC student, and then I built one. I had pretty good mentors with me. So we built an extension to, you know, handle email bounces. Okay, so you can read upon it in the Wikimedia Wiki. So basically, it's like, you know, when you send an email to some guy which is not existing, like instead of tony@gmail.com, you send it to toni@gmail.com, the email just come back, right? So my project was to implement a software which can take back that email, that bounce email, and find out who exactly went up, I mean, what exactly went wrong. So if it's some address issue or some overquota issue or anything, I just tell Wikipedia to stop sending him email. It's simple, but it's kind of a bit complicated when you implement it. And the funny thing is, it got deployed and it's there in like 750 wikis. So, including English Wikipedia, so that's nice. Then, 2015 and 16, I was a GSOC mentor. So 2015, we had a successful project. 2016, we had a failed student. That's bad. So, the C should be capital in GSOC. Okay, sorry. So, because I was creating this slide as an I, this is something. Then 2016, I was an org admin for Outreach and GSOC, just with Wikimedia Foundation. Yeah. Then 2016 and 2017, I was also interned with Igalia, a Spanish company. I worked online. So basically, I can say that all of this thing from here to here just happened because of my 2014 GSOC project. Yeah, even my masters and, you know, because I got a pretty good recommendation letter from my wonderful mentor. He works as a senior technical operations engineer with Wikimedia Foundation. So he brought me a pretty good recommendation letter. That's pretty nice. So these are like some aspects which might interest you, but let me tell you, these are not only the things which should motivate you. But there are a lot of fun involved, but there are all these perks too, which just come along. Okay, there are a couple of conferences and hackathons here and there. Yes, that's nice. So starting with anyone, this might be interesting, okay? Don't sleep. Yes. I was telling this to a couple of you guys yesterday, so sorry, you guys can do something else, you know, just enjoy the time. So just check if you have a language preference, that's the first thing, okay? Like some people just may have some addiction to maybe some language like Python or C or C++. If you have it, good. If you do not have, you know, think about it again. Just you need to have a language preference. So basically, I don't think how correct this is, so all information on this slide are like just from my personal bullshit thinking. So I think all kind of projects and communities which we have, we can broadly divide them into two. One are like, you know, the web related stuff, and the other are like, you know, the software related stuff. So the software related stuff, just like in a C program, you write the code, you compile, and you execute, right? So the web, you just write the scripting thing, you put it in maybe some web server, or you execute it using some in the server or whatever, and you just render it on the browser, okay? So some examples of web thing are like, you know, MediaWiki is a web application, then you got WordPress, WikiToLearn also, the projects are basically on the web. Then you got the software things which are like Linux, kernel, Mozilla and everything. Then KDE, the Qt applications, where you write the application, you compile it, you build it, and then you see the output, okay? So some people might have an interest to do the web, or because it's fast, I mean it's easy, because you don't compile it, but some people are like really addicted to this thing. Okay, so for this you might need a better hardware, like you need to build it. And it's okay, like everyone got an IT or Wi-Fi, so no worries. So just think about all these things. You know, just make a decision, like, you know, should you be going for the web thing or the software? Come on, it's my mission. Yes. Yes. So the web thing or the software thing? So yes. So if you have a language preference, it's very easy. So if you have a language preference like maybe Python, just go to this website g.co/gsoft. That's the gsoft website. Then you need to find an organization. So previously for 2016, it seems like we had 178 organizations to choose from. It's like, you know, getting into a sandwich shop and seeing a lot of, you know, beautiful, colorful things, and it's pretty difficult to select. So the selecting an organization part is like the most important. Guys, don't take notes, okay? These are like things which you should keep in your head. Okay, this is not some boring lecture. Then go to this website, you know, g.co/gsoft. Then you'd see a filter over there in this website where you can actually filter by the language which you choose. Like if you choose Python, just type in Python, then click OK. Then you can just check their past selections and projects. Like, check how many slots it got in 2015 and 16. So if you see it's like 3 and 2 or something, better, I would say, not to choose. I mean, these are like my personal opinion, but just think about it. Like, people all around the world are like fighting for 3 slots. That's gonna be like more competitive than an organization which have like 6 or 7 or 8 slots, right? So just check the past selections in 2015 and 16. You see it's like 6 and 7, I can say it's a safe bet, right? Simple logic. So now once you have found your organization, yes. So you need to do this. Google how to contribute space that organization. So then that's the first thing. Like if it's MediaWiki, how to contribute MediaWiki. It will land you to a page in MediaWiki Wiki, which says, you know, join the IRC channel, join our mailing list, join our bug tracker, etc. This might be different for certain organization, but it would be more or less the same. Oh, this is so boring. Yes. Then the next step, find symbol box. Okay. So symbol, how simple can it be? Like, let me tell you, it can be as simple as fixing a spelling mistake. Yes, it's considered as a very good, valid first bug. Like, my first bug was something like a spelling mistake, yes. not exactly a spelling mistake, but you know, rewording something like your name, a string, your name was taken as your username. Okay. So in MediaWiki installation. So I found it confusing while I was installing MediaWiki, then I reported it and they said, okay, that's bad. We never noticed it, so can you fix it? Yes, I fixed it. So that was my first contribution. Like, I mean, it's not a big thing, but I mean, I can tell you that fixing all the simple stuff, you know, can, of course, aggregate and, you know, get cool with the community. So usually people, you know, get stuck here, can't reproduce a bug, and, you know, they will just get stuck. So once you've found this simple little bug in Bug Tracker, yeah, you don't have to go around the software looking for bugs, okay? So every open source community will have a bug tracker, which is like a listing of, you know, all the essential available bugs. Like, if you want to see this... Wait. Yeah. Like, for Wikimedia Foundation, it's the Fabricator, which actually has a search here, though. So if you search, like, easy, and you see this on the left, you got open tasks. Oh god. Okay. Wait. My mission or the internet or something is not that helpful today. Or probably it's taking a bit of time. Okay. So here you can see, like, see, lot of bugs. Okay. So these bugs might not take more than maybe 3 hours maximum for you to fix. Okay. So, and there are like lots, yes. This is interesting, right? So, back at my time, I put a goal to myself that, you know, I'll just think about something like this. Think about, okay, I will fix one bug every day. So, keep all these kind of goals, which you can practically do, and then start attacking it from one end. Okay. Keep on fixing, and by after 1 month, when you take a look at your GitHub profile or your, you know, contribution profile, you know, you can see that spike. Okay, show off with it. Okay, so that's one thing. Go to the bug tracker and, you know, find out cool stuff. So every organization will have a bug tracker, but for some of them it might be more complicated. So you try to reproduce the bug, and sometimes you get stuck. So when you get stuck, usually there are like two options. Like, either you just remain stuck and you lose interest, you change the organization. Don't do that, okay? So whenever you get stuck, you ask for help, okay? You ask for help either with the IRC channel or with the mailing list, and you try to help yourself by, you know, Googling it. Like I Googled on how to connect to IRC channel previously. You can always find answers by, you know, effectively Googling. These are like, you know, high school stuff which I shouldn't be talking about. Yes. So once you reproduce a bug and you're able to fix it, push it, get it reviewed. So fixing can be a bit complicated, but don't worry, all these vendors are like, you know, just waiting to invite you to help you to fix it. But don't expect it from every organization, because some organization can be a bit shitty sometimes. But most of them are like, you know, more open, you know, more helpful. Yes. Yeah, because some people just get into the IRC channel and say, hey dude, I'm trying to fix this, can somebody help me? And they won't actually say what exactly they are going to fix. And all the 250 developers in that list will be wondering, okay, what exactly is this guy fixing? What exactly help he need? So if you are more specific, like, hey guys, I'm working on so-and-so bug, then in a bracket you give the link. And I was trying to reproduce so-and-so, but I'm stuck at so-and-so, can somebody help me? And the other guy on the IRC channel will be, okay, this guy got something and he's working on something, and he will just answer you. So some people say that if you go with a girl's nickname in IRC channel, you get more replies, I don't know. You guys can try it, okay? Yeah, I know, because there's always this general meaning of the name. I'm really surprised by the crowd over here, because usually when I know it's more or less like, yeah, say that you got some. I think he tried it, yes. Yeah, because IRC, it doesn't have a profile picture thing, so it's safe. Nice. So fix, push, and get it reviewed. Okay. And then, yeah, of sometimes it might be a happy ending, but sometimes you end up with a minus two, like people might just fire. No, people don't fire, but it can happen in some communities. Like if it's Linux kernel and you just send some crap to their mailing list, sometimes somebody might be angry. Okay, I mean, you deserve it. So, are there some basic requirements? These are like some other questions which I usually get. So, people always want, okay, now this is like IIT JEE, so should I get 3 years of pre-training to attend this? No, come on, man. This is not related to anything. So, yes, but there are a couple of things, and these are not as difficult as, you know, the thing which I mentioned earlier. So command or written English, this is really, really important, okay? Written English, not spoken English, written English. So if you have this thing, you know, you can almost crack anything, I guess. Like, even if it's a master's school application or you know, if it's a GSOC, and don't take this for granted, but it's not only your writing skills which matters, but also your techniques. Don't take notes, guys, don't take notes. Keep it in your head, okay? Keep it in your head, okay? So, when you have this written thing, you can easily convince people. Like, you know, the properly punctuated. When I see a paragraph which is like proper, you know, like starting with a capital letter, then properly spaced, a comma and a space after that, no space before that, full stop which has a no space before it and a space after it. You know, you just feel, okay, this guy got something in it. So, let's give him a try. But think about you receiving an email like this. Okay, I got the email. Wait. Where is it? Okay, so think about you get a proposal like this. Okay, what would you think of this guy? Oh, no, don't take photographs, okay? Please don't take photographs because this was in a restricted mailing list and I'm not supposed to show anything. So don't answer. Sorry, guys, you'll have to remove it. Okay. It's okay. So this thing actually happened in the GSOC mailing list. I showed this to a couple of you guys yesterday. So there was this random guy from some random college, university probably from, old country. Then he was sending out proposals like this. Just take a look at it. So it's all capital letter. So, when you see capital letter, the first thing which comes to your mind is, you know, it's shouting, okay? When you write two or three words in capital letter in an English written something, it's considered as shouting. People get so offended that, you know, they will kick you out from their IRC channel or whatever. Or if it's a mailing list, they will ban you. If it's somewhere else, they will try to remove you from their memory, okay? So don't ever try this, you know, you need to have that skill of, you know, writing things in, like take a look at this. This was written by the vendor, okay. So this is properly spaced, a single space between letters, then single space after, you know, after dot, then single space after comma, no space between, before, yes. This is good. Yeah, so this was by the vendor, and see, this is by the student. So this thing was kind of like a spam, like, we got one exactly. So, oh yeah, KDE also got that. Then Postgres SQL got identical proposals. Then some other organization got 5 proposals with the same thing. Okay. So, yeah. So this thing really happened, okay, last year. So that's why it's always good if you have a strong written, you know, communication skill. And we cannot blame you because still in our English literature curriculum, of our plus one and plus two, we are still asked to write telegrams, right? You guys have telegram?
Yes.
I don't know, what the hell, why are they doing it? So these things won't ever change, so how to gain the skill? Okay, rather than just tell you that you need English skills, how to do it? So if you are from a university, try to, you know, maybe say a couple of you guys interested, create a mailing list. Okay, mailing list, you know mailing list, right? Just go to groups.google.com, create a mailing list for you guys, and then start sending out daily status updates. Like, every day you send a status update to the mailing list, telling, okay, today I did these and these things, so tomorrow I plan to do this and this stuff. So, this should come out proactively, but if you're really interested and you email every single day, but after maybe a couple of weeks, your email things will just improve like anything. Because if I take a look at what the emails which I sent back in 2012, it was more or less like that email. No, not like that thing, because that's utter bullshit. I don't use total capitalists anyway, but I mean, it never had real, you know, punctuation and all the spacing and everything. But if you start writing email every single day, it really improves, okay? So this will really help you in your applying for GSOC or whatever, and maybe later when you want to apply for a master's, you have to write this one thing, your statement of proposal or your motivation letter. So some people find it really, really difficult because, you know, writing two or three paragraphs without any punctuation mistake and, you know, with all that style is kind of like really, really difficult.
Come on.
Okay. So if you have that skill of, you know, daily writing something, this is good. And one other thing you should do is start a technical blog. Okay. Write about something. Maybe write about this bullshit session you're having. So, maybe later. So start a technical blog or go to WordPress.com and start a new site. I have one like ttdwrites.wordpress.com. Some people call it ttdsites.wordpress.com. I don't know. That guy. Okay. So, yeah. So especially when you're communicating in a standard mailing list, you should make sure that you have that mailing etiquette. You can search email etiquette and I think this the first result would be something like 101 email etiquette. I have done it before. So just go read through it. There are a lot of things. God, come on. Yes. So understanding some basic version and all tied on even though. Yeah. So you need to understand some basics of Git. Okay. So I cannot tell Git because some projects do not use Git. But the concepts are more or less the same. You need to understand why exactly we use Git. So understanding Git is really, really difficult. Like it took like two or three years for me to really understand. But I really went deep into it with my latest internship with Igalia. Like my mentor was so crazy that, you know, he won't allow me to think about it like this. I made 5 changes, like I added 5 features and there was a mistake in the first one. So usually what you do, you make a 6th change, changing the first one, right? Like 5 changes and you later see that the first one had some mistake. So you send in a 6th change which fixed the first one. But he told, no, go back to the first one, fix it, and then, you know, rebase all the others all there. So, but that really helped and, you know, I understand more of Git these days. So Git is one thing which you understand only after, you know, repeatedly trying it out, not like the boring lectures. So command in your favorite programming or scripting language, this can be improved over time too. Okay, so that all points to my previous slide, which says you need to have a favorite language. So for me, it's like, yeah, Python. Python is so cool with me, I don't know. Python and a bit of PHP. Yeah, so you need to have command over it. So if you find out one programming language which is good for you, I would recommend select an organization which use that and, you know, try working on their code, or maybe if it's a web application related language, you know, try to create a web application maybe for the university or some freelance thing. Then have a great GitHub profile and a technical blog. So telling about GitHub profile, I can show, not mine, okay, I can show this guy's. No, this guy is me. I'll show this guy. Okay. So he was my mentor, okay. So think about this guy applying for an internship or a job, okay. So you see this contributions in the last year, okay. So it's like, so some days he never even had sleep, it seems. So just take a look at it, and, you know, rather than trying to improve our Instagram or Facebook profile, think about improving your GitHub profile. So maybe as a new year resolution, think about it like, okay, I will fix one bug every single day. I tried doing it, but, you know, it's difficult. Some nights, you cannot. Yes, especially during the weekends, it's very difficult. So just try doing it. See, these are things which you do to your own mind. Okay, so just try. I really have this institution of my profile. So have a great GitHub profile and a technical blog. Then skill to get help, etiquette, etc. This is really important, okay. the skill to get help. Like, when you ask a question, you need to make the mentor or some other guy in the community respond to you. Okay, that's really difficult because when you take a look at an IRC channel, God's sake. Okay, so if it's a hash Wikimedia node, there are like around 181 mentors, or not all of them are mentors, but probably developers. And you post a question over here, there's like less than zero chance that anybody would mind it firstly and reply to it, right? Because those people don't care. I mean, they don't have to worry about you, but open source developers are so good, they would. But, you know, only if you make the question in such a way that you force them to reply. Like, you need to frame that sentence like what I told, like, I was working on blah 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 and I hit across this and this, so can you just help me out? Okay, that kind of a question here would make sense. So when I type that thing and hit enter, you know, all these guys would see the question and, you know, maybe one of them might be interested to reply. But always Indians have this issue because we are in the wrong time zone. Like, we are like 6 hours away from, you know, 12 hours away from the US time zone where most of the developers are concentrated. Probably the Europe too, and we are like 5 hours away. Not five? Three and a half. No, 4 hours. So, and especially during weekends, don't expect many replies because developers also have life. But some of them are like really crazy. Like some of them, like I see this guy, this Lego KDM, he was my mentor. So, I mean, when I was doing my GSOC project, I saw this guy like in the night, he's helping me out, and I go to sleep, and when I wake up, he's still there. And then I just replied, like, okay, so can we work on this? Then he told me, okay, I just woke up, maybe I'll go and brush my teeth, and I'll have food and come back. So he woke up, and I think he just woke up directly to the computer. These kind of guys. Yeah, but open source developers are so passionate, they'll do anything. And, just so happy to do it. I don't know. It's just the motivation. Okay, so that's it. So the GSOC and updates thing, yeah, this is gonna be a bit boring. You can always find the same information on the internet. Ah, bullets and numbers. I just hate it because it just reminds me of my lectures. So yeah. So some basic difference. GSOC is basically for university students. Outreaching is not exactly for university students. But there are some special cases when, you know, if you are a non-male and you match some certain criteria, you can appear for outreaching. Okay, so for males, we just have this thing. Sorry guys, for the females, they have outreaching and, you know, all the other stuff. But the stipend is still the same for just male users, but there are some catch, yeah, actually. So, have projects in all languages. In all, I won't say all, I mean, this was a mistake. Probably all, okay, because you cannot have all languages. So you got these mentors and org admins. So mentors are the one who is gonna decide on your selection. So what happens is, you know, when Google announces this GSOC thing, like for the next round, like 2017, all these organizations apply to GSOC. So the org admins do it. So we apply to Google to select us, and it's Google's party and Google's call. So there's not even a chance that Google will accept you, but you can always predict the future, right? That's what Sherlock Holmes says. How many of you watch Sherlock Holmes? Great. Did you watch the latest one?
Yeah.
That's disappointing, bad, worse. The last one just kind of like bad. So I don't know, I expect a bit more. I hope they don't stop it. So yeah, predicting the future. So you just check out the, it's so hard also. So just predict, I mean, just see how many selections they had for 2015 and 16, and then you can just predict, okay, will we get selected for 2017. So we got 178 odds. The next one is in March 2017, so this is already January 19, so you guys are up close. So for the outreach thing, so almost everything is same as GSOC, but there they have projects which are not strictly code related. Guys, okay. Okay, so but for GSOC it's only code related projects, okay. So only the coding guys. So then blah blah blah. So university students. So girls, if you want to participate in this thing, you have to meet two criteria. One is that, so in that particular semester when this outreach is happening, you shouldn't be taking more credits than half of the total credits any other girl, any other, you know, student in that semester takes. Like if it's your third semester and the usual credits are like 25 credits, and if you are taking like more than 13 credits that semester and you apply for authority, it's not going to get accepted. Because all guidelines are supposed to make it clear that we check your academic calendar and we have to do it. I mean, I and the category, we personally have to do it. So if, I mean, so probably maybe it works for your last semester when, you know, you have one electives. So you can skip a couple of your electives and take it. So there's one more thing. Outreach can be considered as your final year project too. This is only for the girls. Guys, okay, so I think some of you are thinking of, okay, how about making a girls profile and just applying and get the money? Maybe if you have a particularly good and happy girlfriend, you can apply to her name, but make sure she doesn't escape the money. So, probably after getting the first installment, she'll say, okay, now no more, I get it. So keep this in mind, okay, don't do those things, okay, so if you get caught, you're like, damn for life. Maybe you can change your name. So, don't wait, okay. Oh, is it being recorded? Oh, shit. So then some general, oh, am I talking too much? Yes, like any other day? Yes, come back. So there's a stipend of $5,500, but you see this costume up? Guys, it's gonna change, okay? So this time during the GSOC Mentor Summit, yes, I'm showing off my t-shirt. So they were thinking of changing it, okay? Like they're gonna change it like to be cost of living based remuneration, like